Thank you. I'll try to give a brief overview of the evolution and prospects for cellular therapies in diabetes, and it's been really a pleasure to be at this conference, and I enjoyed a lot of the presentation, so thank to the organizer for including me. I come from the Diabetes Research Institute at the University of Miami. As introduction, is a center that has been set up and funded exclusively to find the cure for type 1 diabetes, and has a very simple mission to cure diabetes in the fastest, most efficient, and safest way possible. Has a tower that is all dedicated to cellular therapies and tissue engineering, nanotechnology, but all geared around the diabetes cure. And one floor of the facility is dedicated to human cell processing for clinical trial. This is a picture of me a few weeks ago when we started this effort. Was like actually in 88, 86, 88 at Washington University in St. Louis. And what we developed was the system to extract the insulin producing cells from the human pancreas through a continuous flow and module in which the islets are progressively separated and purified from the human pancreas that is disassembled and under a continuous digestion system. And then we performed the first successful clinical trial when I moved to the University of Pittsburgh with Dr. Starzl, and it seems that the problem of diabetes was solved. The first six patients were cured, and we started the Cell Transplant Society with Dr. Starzl, the journal Cell Transplantation, and it seemed that everything was resolved back then in 1990. And then the challenges started taking over, and we don't have time in the 20 minutes to go to the history of the last 25 years, but there is a wonderful review available online, open access on Cellar4, for those of you interested to see what happened to islet transplantation since the introduction of the automated method for islet isolation. So to jump to today, like 25 years later, now we just completed the Phase III trial, FDA Phase III trial sponsored by NIH that involved several centers in North America and Europe to bring islet transplantation towards approval and eventual reimbursement also in the United States for the most severe cases of type 1 diabetes in which you can justify anti-rejection therapy for life, which is currently the main limitation to the wide application of this procedure because you introduce risk factors associated to infection, cancer, organ toxicity, so you better have a very good reason to undergo a transplant. So now this the reason is that there are a subset of patients that have severe hypoglycemia and hypoglycemia awareness. This is still a very big problem in type 1 diabetes, especially after 15 years or more of the disease from the onset. And what you can achieve in these patients with an islet transplant, this is one of these patients with an insulin pump before the islet transplant, and you see the glucose levels that go from over 500 to less than 20, big swings. And after the islet transplant stabilization with a successful transplant, this is 2 years post-transplant with a continuous glucose monitor, you have a very good range of glucose throughout the days. And this is truly remarkable. There are now, the success rate is pretty much approaching that of organ transplantation, but it took 2 decades to bring the field to where we are now. So now the challenge for the future is how do we bring this procedure to everyone that may need a transplant of insulin-producing cells, and not just type 1 patients with type 1 diabetes, but also several with type 2 that are requiring insulin as an evolution of the disease towards beta cell dysfunction. So the key target now of the research strategies and translational strategies we're carrying forward are developing immune tolerance and then the problem of supply. How do you have enough insulin-producing cells to treat all? Because if you now can do an islet transplant without immunosuppression, everybody will want transplant of insulin-producing cells, not just the most severe cases, and we have only 1,500 pancreas available per year in the United States, and millions of patients possibly desiring the procedure. So supply is a big issue, and that's why there is so much interest in stem cell or xenograft and alternative sources. So on the tolerance induction, we're trying now to move towards engineering a site for islet transplantation that include like scaffolds and technology that go from conformal coating encapsulation to provide a semi-permeable barrier to protect the cells from the immune attack, to co-transplanting helper cells that can provide immunomodulation locally, like mesenchymal stem cells, regulatory T cells, as well as enhancing the graft, like with oxygen generation materials that can provide oxygen until the graft is fully revascularized, and also local drug delivery to try to modulate the microenvironment, but without having to give immunosuppression systemically to the recipient. There are also an increasing number of companies that traditionally were staying away from cellular therapy that are beginning to approach the field of tolerance induction. And besides mesoblast with mesenchymal stem cell transplant approach, there is a Novartis just signed recently a major licensing with Susan Ilstad's company, Regenerex, to bring forward to the clinic a procedure for tolerance induction that I'll describe in a minute, as well as Neostem, who bought the whole intellectual property package from BD for regulatory T cell expansion, and from Jeff Bluestone Technology to the European equivalent. So you see movements in the area of tolerance induction that are very, very interesting. We started collaborating with a network of centers that we have around the world that comprise the Diabetes Research Institute Federation. One of the most successful trials has been with China to replace induction immunosuppression with mesenchymal stem cell infusion in kidney transplantation. And this is a strategy that was recently published in JAMA, but will be now combined with other tolerance induction protocols. And this is the approach of Susan Ilstad and collaborator. Is actually an old patent and an approach to induce chimerism at high dose, that meaning replacing the immune system of the recipient with that of a donor. This has a double target, that in case of an organ transplant, you don't need any more immunosuppression if you transplant cell tissue or organs from the same donor once you have replaced the recipient immune system with that of the donor. But the other advantage is that if you have an autoimmune disease such as type 1 diabetes or any other autoimmune condition, replacing the immune system with that of a non-autoimmune donor will solve also the underlying autoimmune condition. So it's potentially a double target for our purposes, and is based on the concept of purifying these facilitating cells from the donor bone marrow, and purifying by an intense T-cell depletion the residual bone marrow, and the combination give you a cell product that prevent the risk of GVH, favor regulatory T-cell subset, and has been already in clinical trials. There are over 20 patients treated in kidney transplant setting with up to over 5 years of drug-free organ transplant survival. So it's a major development, and I'm sure you'll hear more about these trials. Now they've been done in organ transplantation at Northwestern in Chicago, Duke for metabolic disease condition, and hopefully soon with us for diabetes and islet transplant. So the other trials that are beginning at the clinical level are with expanded regulatory T cells from Jeff Bluestone and collaborators at UCSF, and there is a cluster of centers that will be, including our own, that will test this strategy for blocking type 1 diabetes at the onset. And another very interesting approach that have been just tested and presented at the ADA 2 months ago as an oral presentation is this combination of a low dose ATG anti-thymocyte globulin with GCSF, with the Neulasta, like this stem cell factor that was given originally just to reconstitute when you have a low blood count of white blood cells in bone marrow transplantation or in chemotherapy or in organ transplant when you do a T-cell depletion very strong at the beginning. Now it turns out that GCSF has also an immunomodulatory effect stimulating myeloid-derived suppressor cells and then regulatory T-cells, so it seems for the first time in diabetes, this is the first time that an intervention trial was able to preserve insulin secretion for 1 year compared to the control where you have a decrease. And generally, up to this point, all the other trials were showing just a shift of the curve to the right and a delay in disappearance of insulin from patients, but never a full preservation. So now, when tolerance induction will be possible, then the critical issue becomes what source of cells to select. And here you have all the usual suspects from embryonic stem cells, xenotransplantation like porcine islets that have an insulin virtually identical to human insulin that differs only by one amino acid. But there you have the problem of even a higher challenge to prevent rejection or induce tolerance. And then all the stem cell sources from embryonic to adult stem cells that may have the advantage if they come from the patient own body to avoid the problem of alloreactivity, even if you still have to deal with the autoimmune disease condition that wipe out the insulin producing cells to begin with. So in embryonic stem cells has been quite a challenge because the pathway to generating the insulin producing cells is quite complex, and there has been the Viacite group now has an approach that was just last week approved by FDA to move forward to clinical trials, and their approach, we will be one of the centers testing also this procedure. We practically carry the differentiation from human embryonic stem cells to an intermediate endocrine. You don't go all the way to insulin producing cells, but then these cells are loaded in an immuno-isolating macro device that is placed subcutaneously. And here you see the initial preclinical testing in mice showing the cells within the device with very good survival post-transplant, insulin, glucagon, and somatostatin hormonal staining. And you have a maturation in the weeks following the in vivo implantation. So it's like a partial differentiation before transplant and then maturation in vivo. So how do we manage to complete the process in vitro? Now we're testing a new strategy to complete the differentiation before transplant using lessons from the embryonic recapitulation of what is the microenvironment in the development of a human pancreas. And you have a very key element when you have the so-called secondary transition in which an ingrowth of blood vessel and capillaries in the pancreas parallel the development of the islets of the endocrine component. So from that point on, the islets see the highest level of oxygen in the human body together with the renal capsule with the renal cortex. And so then we tested if in vitro, if modulation of the oxygen environment could favor this differentiation. And was we initially used this to prevent central necrosis that you develop in culture when cluster of tissue are expanding and growing in culture. But to our surprise, besides preventing central necrosis, we also had a 30-fold increase in differentiation towards insulin producing cells. So this is a very novel technology. It's based on a perfluorocarbon silicon membrane that allow oxygen to diffuse from below the cell culture besides above. So instead of having a traditional flask or petri dish where oxygen has to diffuse just from above. And you'll hear more, I'm sure, about this as well. So now another important change is like the difference between mouse and human pancreas as far as potential for reprogramming the T tissue to become insulin producing, because unlike mice, humans have a scatter carpet of progenitor cells into the exocrine and are cells that express PDX1 that traditionally is expressed only in the islet if you go to a mouse pancreas. And this can become the target of endogenous regeneration approach once you have restored self-tolerance to type 1 diabetes. And there have been approach, this is the paper by Doug Melton group at Harvard, reprogramming exocrine pancreas in rodents to beta cells, and with some partial success in this direction. We have been interested to do this approach, moving from gene therapy to protein transduction technology. And most recently, in the last year, there is a new approach emerging, that is epigenetic conversion of fibroblasts from a skin biopsy. It could be done like at the clinical level, expanding primary fibroblast culture from the patient and then converting this epigenetically with a brief demethylation step with 5-ASA towards then a pancreatic differentiation protocol that has been already, it's been published in PNAS and was successful reversing diabetes in animal, in nude mice that could not reject the human tissue with the cells obtained from human subject. So this is a phenomenon that is very interesting because there have been several studies indicating how you can convert different subpopulation of cells from the human pancreas into beta cells. And this just came out 2 days ago in Nature, and is a very nice study showing how age-dependent conversion of pancreatic delta cells can occur into insulin-producing cells, not just alpha cells. So this is another cell subset that can convert into insulin-producing cells. Then finally, I also want to mention a new cell therapy procedure that is still new in the United States, but there are already over 2,000 cases performed in Europe and has already received the CE mark and the equivalent approval in Australia, and the 510K is being seeked in the United States, hopefully in the next several months. And it includes a non-enzymatic method to treat liposuction, lipoaspirate, like mini liposuction. But unlike cytory or other cell processing of adipose-derived cell products with enzyme, you don't use any enzyme, and it occurs in a full immersion system when you have a progressive cluster reduction in size. And the final product that is very fluid and was done originally by a plastic surgeon to use smaller needle and insulin needle to do lipofilling with this micronized fat compared to the traditional Coleman lipofilling. It is giving like some biologic effect and results that were completely unexpected, and not just in diabetic ulcers or burns or wound healing, but for a number of of regenerative medicine applications. And there is a paper that just was published in Cellular 4 on the plastic orthognathic surgery application, and there are more in the pipeline, but this is just a partial list of clinical application where this system has been tested. And besides diabetic ulcers, one of the key areas is becoming orthopedic application because of the ability of this tissue to regenerate cartilage. So this is a before and after, and interestingly started all in a racing horse that couldn't walk anymore and is back jumping. So that from the veterinary application, now there is a multicenter trial plan in orthopedic reference centers in Europe to test this procedure. And this is just a biopsy of the cartilage newly formed. The last thing I'd like to mention very briefly is exosomes. Like, we're moving beyond cellular product in regenerative medicine. There is more and more technology emerging on the relevance of microvesicles as delivery system of messages or factors that can promote regenerative medicine application. This just came out very recently, showing how human MSCs-derived microvesicles can actually modulate T cell response to islet antigens, to autoantigens in patients with type 1 diabetes. And I don't have time to enter in the detail of these experiments, but is a field, the whole extracellular vesicle release is a field that, of course, is in many areas, but in diabetes and tolerance induction and beta cell regeneration as well. So this is a very promising field. In this application, we are actually engineering factors like microRNA 7 and anti-microRNA 7 to modulate beta cell replication. So you load exosome with this it's practically a viral gene transfer approach, and then promote regeneration of the islet insulin-producing cells. So this is part of our team. There are over 160 subjects and scientists working at the DRI in Miami, and many more in the centers of the DRI Federation. And as a take-home message, we have like embryonic stem cell trials that are approved by FDA, MSC that are already in clinical trials, tolerance induction, clinical protocols that have started phase 1-2 testing, transdifferentiation, tissue reprogramming, and epigenetic conversion strategies that are instead still at the preclinical level, and exosome and microvesicle that are moving regenerative medicine application beyond cellular product. So I'd like to thank all of our collaborators at the DRI and at centers worldwide working with us, and I invite you all to go and check out this new journal that just celebrated the 1-year birthday a month ago. Thank you.